In part one, we learned that if you configure the DoMore from the top down, and you understand that the DoMore is device-centric, then things make a lot more sense, and the DoMore projects just seem to flow easier. In this video, we'll use a DoMore to operate a simple box diverter like this. We'll need a motor that we can control with a variable frequency drive to manage the conveyor loads. We'll use a barcode scanner to scan the box and tell us where to send it. We'll use an encoder to tell us how long to run a diverter motor, which can change with different size boxes. We'll need some inputs to monitor the various sensors, and we'll need some outputs to control the pneumatics that lift the diverter. This is just a contrived scenario that intentionally uses a wide variety of automation hardware, so we'll have several different kinds of devices to practice setting up and configuring. We need to talk to the barcode scanner from the CPU serial port. We'll use a high-speed counter module to count the encoder pulses. We'll use the DoMore's onboard Ethernet port to talk to the variable frequency drive, and we'll have digital input and output modules to control the pneumatics, the diverter motor, and read the status of the photo sensors. I've already plugged in the hardware modules into the base, turned it on, and connected the DoMore with a new blank project. Let's start with the barcode reader on the serial port. In the CPU configuration, we see that the serial port device already exists, so we just choose how we want it to behave. Our barcode reader just sends out ASCII text, so we'll use this as a general purpose serial port and configure the COM port parameters to match those of the barcode reader. You can see the default name of the serial port device starts with the @. All devices default to that, so you know the DoMore thinks it's a device. This says it's the internal serial port device. The serial port doesn't affect IO configuration, and it's not an added module, so our next stop is device configuration. Here's our serial port device, along with all the other devices that the DoMore automatically created for us. Remember, these are all devices that DoMore creates for us out of the box. We didn't have to do anything. Some of them are ready now, and the rest we just set up a few parameters and they're ready to go. We're working on a serial port right now, so let's edit that one. Well, there's really nothing to do here, is there? We already set all the parameters back in the CPU configuration, so this serial port's ready to go. The serial port doesn't affect any of the I/O mappings, and if we look at the memory configuration, we see the serial port heap item. That's the chunk of memory that's been allocated automatically by the DoMore for the serial port to use. You don't have to worry about reserving memory or creating buffers for the serial port. The DoMore manages all of that for you. We'll take a closer look at the memory elements that the DoMore creates for us in just a minute. So what did we do to get a functioning serial port? Well, we just selected what flavor we wanted and set the port parameters. We walked through the rest of these, but there really wasn't anything to do, was there? Easy. There's a dedicated video that goes into great detail about how to use a barcode scanner with the DoMore. Check that out if you want to learn more about barcode scanning. We wired the encoder to the counter I/O module, which I also call the Citrio module, like this, with the encoder open collector outputs going into channel 1A and 1B, and a common tied to the plus rail. Let's go back to the top and work our way down. Does the Citrio module have anything to do with the CPU? No. Under I/O configuration, we see that the DoMore has already found the Citrio module here in slot 2. We didn't have to do anything to discover this module, did we? That's because the DoMore was in auto discover mode. If you're in manual mode, you can change the modules manually here if you want to. That all looks good, so let's move down to the module configuration. Here's a list of all of the configurable modules, which we only have one. Select it, click on Edit, and Configure I/O. We want a quad counter so we can tell which direction the encoder is rotating, and let's call this device encoder. Hit OK, and now we have a fully configured encoder device. Again, all we did was go into the module configurations, select the Citrio module, and create a quad counter device, which we named encoder. We didn't have to do anything special to initialize a Citrio module. It only took us a couple seconds to fully configure our encoder device. If we look at the device configuration, we see the encoder device sitting there waiting for us to use it. Look, no configuration required. We have already done everything we need to do. You still see the Citrio device. He's the global device for that module that takes care of all the common parameters, and there can be many sub-devices like this encoder depending on how many things you have connected to the Citrio module. I/O mappings. We didn't use any of the Citrio I/O bits, so there's nothing here to do. And memory configuration. If we scroll down to the bottom, we see our encoder heap item, or structure. It begins with a $ to differentiate it from the device, which starts with an @. This is the structured memory that DoMore set aside for this device, which is really cool because we didn't have to set aside any memory for this device either, did we? The DoMore literally did everything for us. You can also see the structure for the counter I/O module itself. It contains things that are common to all the devices and functions of the module, like error codes and status flags and mode information, things like that. Since we're at the bottom of the list, we know we're done with the encoder configuration. So I'm going to exit for a second and show you that over here, under memory, there's a list of every memory item in the entire system, so we should be able to find our encoder structure in here somewhere, right? Sure enough, under I/O, Specialty, there's the encoder, and you can even see all of the members and what type each member is. Signed D-word, real, bit, etc. Very cool. If I download these changes to the Do More, add a data view to monitor the encoder, and the .ireg1 is the register that stores channel 1's counter data. Put the Do More in run mode, turn the encoder, and just like that, we see the encoder counting. And again, while I've been taking a lot of time to explain things, all we really did was under module configuration, tell the Citrio what flavor device we wanted on channel 1, and gave it a name of encoder. That's it. The Do More designer did everything else for us. It's so easy. Let's set up the variable frequency drive on the Ethernet port. Where do we start? Same place as before. Go to hardware configuration and start at the top with CPU and work our way down the configuration list. Enable the Ethernet I/O since that's how we talk to the GSE Drive 100. That creates a new Ethernet I/O entry in our I/O configuration. Click on that to configure the Ethernet I/O network. You can change the Do More's IP configuration here and modify the slaves down here. Now before you add slaves to this Ethernet I/O master list, you need to make sure that they're all in the Do More's domain. How do you do that? Just like everything else. Start at the top, work your way down. This first button scans the network and identifies all of the Ethernet I/O compatible devices. Let's get this IP address on the Do More's network, and let's change the device name to conveyor motor. Remember, everything in this dialog are all items that are getting changed on the actual variable frequency drive, not in our Do More program. Hit OK, wait for the drive to get updated, and we're good to go. Now that I know all my hardware is configured for this domain, I click here to scan the network, select the ones I want to use, and add the ones I selected. That's it. We now have a new GS1 device we can use to manage and control the GSE Drive 100 and GS1 VFD, which we can see a picture of here. This guy's a smart Ethernet to 485 converter specifically for use with the GS series drives. Under module configuration, there really isn't anything to configure except the module name, which we could change to conveyor motor if we wanted to, but I think we'll leave it at GS1 to remind us what kind of drive we're talking to. We're done with that. Under device configuration, we see our GS1 device that we'll use to control the drive. There's nothing to do here. Under I/O mapping, we see our new drive under Ethernet I/O master, and at the memory allocated for this guy is a structure named GS1100. Remember, the structure you use to access a device always has the same name as the device, so it's really easy to remember. Under memory configuration, scroll down to the bottom, and we see our new GS1 structure. Again, same name as the device. Well, we're at the bottom of the configuration list, so we must be done with our drive configuration. And again, all we did was enable the Ethernet I/O master, scan for devices, and configure the GSE drive. And once again, the Do More did all the heavy lifting. It created the device, allocated memory, built the structure, created the status flags, all that stuff. There's a 4-part series of videos that goes into a lot of detail about using Ethernet I/O with GS drives. Check out those videos to get the most out of using the Do More with Ethernet I/O and GS drives. Just for fun, let's download this configuration to the Do More and test this device. In a data view, I'll add the GS1 drive's output frequency, direction, and run command. Simply by setting these parameters in a data view, I can control the motor in a drive. And remember, the Do More set all of this up for me. All we did was enable the Ethernet I/O and scan for the drive. Setting up the input and output modules is easy. We'll start back at the top of the configuration list, just like everything else. These don't impact the CPU, so there's nothing to do here. In the I/O configuration, we can see that the Do More automatically identified the input module and mapped it to memory for us simply because we plugged it in. You can add modules manually by selecting this radio button, and then down here, right-click on the slot to choose your module. I don't have an output module yet, so I'll drop one in manually in this slot. There's no module configuration for these guys, and there's no device configuration for discrete I/O modules. The I/O master takes care of all of that for us. I/O mappings. You'll want to leave that on automatic most of the time. But if you want to reserve memory for a future module, you can always switch over to manual and force the I/O mapping to be whatever you want. Finally, there is no memory configuration for the I/O, so we're done configuring all of the devices we need for our project. So think about that. In just a few minutes, we completely configured this system and even ran a couple live demos, and most of that time was me taking time to explain everything. Some were trivial, some were more complicated, but all of them used the exact same methodology. We click on configuration and work our way down this list. And that's the beauty of the Do More. It doesn't matter how simple or complicated the hardware is that you want to talk to. If you approach it like we did with these devices, everything just falls into place, and even the most complicated device only takes seconds to set up and configure because the Do More does all the heavy lifting. That's amazing. In this video, we focused on how to configure the devices we'll need. In the next video, we'll put these devices to use, and you'll get a whole new appreciation of how incredibly powerful this device-centric model is. If you need any help, please contact Automation Direct's free, award-winning tech support during regular business hours. They'll be happy to help you. And don't forget the forums. There's lots of folks there that love to share their years of experience. Just don't post any questions directed at Automation Direct support staff there. They don't monitor the forums on a regular basis.